And both of the other Chrises sparred in last night's One News leaders debate, but neither failed to deliver a knockout blow.
I want hard-working, lower middle-income Kiwis to get tax relief to deal
with
the cost of living crisis.
You support working people by making their wages grow. You support working families by making sure their wages are growing.
Correct.
And yet the National Party has opposed every increase to the minimum wage.
No.
I don't think it's fair to consign Māori to poorer health outcomes than non-Māori New Zealanders.
Every outcome's gone backwards, Chris, under your government. Every single health outcome for Māori or non-Māori. We need powerful, targeted interventions in these young people's lives. I'm not prepared to write them off. We've got to teach them rights and responsibilities.
Jessica, boot camps have a near 80% failure rate. All of the commitments I put before the electorate this election will be things that I'm absolutely confident we can deliver on in the next 3 years.
No, I honestly come from outside of politics. I'm not a career politician like Chris or many others that are there. I've come to this job because I choose to do the job, because I want to do the job, because I think the country can be so much better than this.
But there was also a whole lot of agreeing going on.
Is now the time for New Zealand to become a republic?
No.
No.
Should we continue to ban nuclear-powered ships from our waters?
Yes.
Yes.
Should cannabis be decriminalised?
No.
No.
Should vapes be prescription only?
No.
No, not at this stage, but I am interested to see what else we need to do to get it under control.
Bilingual road signs and for public buildings, yes or no?
Yes.
Yes.
4-year term.
I personally have a lot of appetite for that, because I think you'd throw governments out after 4 years rather than...
As a political reporter, I don't have appetite for that. 4-year term.
Yes, I believe in a 4-year term.
Personally, would you be happy to pay wealth tax?
No, I think it would be a wrecking ball through the economy.
I don't think a wealth tax is the way to go.
So, here to give their thoughts on the shenanigans are former National Deputy Prime Minister Paula Bennett and former Labor Cabinet Minister Iain Lees-Galloway. Morena.
Good morning. Well, here we are.
Can either of you make sense of what happened last night? Was there a winner? Can we decide it this morning?
Well, if you want a really good demonstration of why the minor parties have been doing well in this campaign, look no further than last night's debate. All that agreeing, you know, people are looking at the two leaders and going, what's the difference between the two parties?
But see, I kind of loved it. I think there is differences and quite big differences in how it's run. But I kind of like that we're a more centrist country and that we don't have those extreme rights and extreme lefts that are kind of sitting there and playing off so we see in some other countries.
I don't think we actually have parties that are at the extreme right or the extreme left, but you can see why the Greens and ACT and Te Pāti Māori and now New Zealand First are doing well, because people want something a bit different. People want some flavour to their election.
And that's the feedback we're getting. People saying, I was an undecided voter before we went into last night's debate. I'm an undecided voter again, because I can't make sense of which of these two parties are going to actually deliver on what they're saying.
Thought that Luxon came out really strong, actually. I think he looked, he was eloquent, he was articulate, he got his message across. Hipkins had kind of everything to lose and he didn't step up to it. So we heard from him a few weeks ago, wait till the campaign starts and then you'll see me getting in there. And then it was like, well, wait for the debates and then you'll see me kind of getting in there. And he's kind of really looked flat on both counts, I reckon. So he needed to step up last night and really try and turn that polling around, and he didn't, and I believe that Christopher Luxon did.
Mikey Sherman on the panel post the debate said to Jack Tame that she was hoping for a bit more mongrel in Hipkins last night.
Yeah, I don't think Luxon outshone Chris Hipkins in any way whatsoever. I think Chris Hipkins was surprisingly strong on law and order, and he really... I think the word was used, ankle-tapped Chris Luxon last night on boot camps and the fact that they just don't work, and everybody knows they don't work. And Chris Hipkins was really strong on climate change as well, really pulling apart National's policies and pointing out the fact that actually under Labor emissions have fallen, which Christopher Luxon said was a good thing, but he also plans to undo all the things that Labor's put in place to make those emissions come down. But Paul is right in a way. What I think last night it was Chris Hipkins who really needed the slam dunk moment. Neither of them had one. So you say, OK, well, maybe that's probably good for Chris Luxon.
I was going to ask you whether there was a particular moment in last night's debate where you went, there we go, there we go. Was there a moment for you
No,
like
there
that?
Wasn't, and I'm OK with it. I know that sounds, but I just think that we've kind of been moving more and more over the last few years, and I mean more than six, actually, but more into that kind of all about the person and trying to knock others down. And I think we're at a point now where we're genuinely interested in the policy, the type of leadership we're going to have, and on delivery. And I think that in that respect, it was a reasoned debate where they both got points across. But, you know, people have been saying they don't know Christopher Luxon. Well, I think he stood up last night and showed himself as to what sort of Prime Minister he'll be. And that will be, you know, strong, it will be delivering, and I believed in it.
That was one of the points we made earlier, was are people in this debate actually looking for policy? Because we get that from the politicians all the time, where they come on here all the time and talk about where they want to take things. So are we actually then, in a debate, looking for who do we want to lead this country?
I think we are, and I think Chris Hipkins did well on that last night, because he was able to articulate how the policy actually will affect people in their real day-to-day lives and how it will achieve the outcomes that we want in the future. And I think he did a really good job of, again, pulling apart where the gap between Nationals' rhetoric and their actual policies and what they will actually do. So I think Chris Hipkins demonstrated the leadership that we need in someone who can actually think through the policies and the way they actually will impact people's lives in real day-to-day situations. Well,
and the counterfactual to that, I thought, was Luxon being really strong and saying, you've had 6 years. You know, because it was sort of full of this, what we're going to do next or what the problems are. And I thought that him sort of going back time and time again and saying, well, you know, you've had 6 years and where's the new ideas to actually deliver on all of these things?
Well, on new ideas, where are Nationals' new ideas? They are absent. They have had 6 years in opposition to actually come up with something creative and new. And I think what Luxon showed last night is National just kind of wants to wind the clock back to the John Key days.
OK, one of the major things, of course, at the moment is this cost of living crisis that so many people are feeling the pinch, and it's just getting worse. So people last night, I'm assuming, wanted to sit there and go, who is going to help me feel better? Who is going to help me be able to put food on the table, gas in the tank, all of that kind of thing?
Yeah.
National, of course, is promising tax cuts, but for some people it's as little as $10 a week, which, let's be honest, is going to go nowhere in terms of paying rent, paying fuel. But then on the other side, it's Labor offering GST off fruit and veg, which just has not landed as a policy. So are either of these parties really coming out with something that's going to make meaningful difference when it comes to economic policy?
I felt that one of the weaker moments last night was when was one of the viewers' questions, and it was like, you know, what's in it for my daughter in 10 years' time? You know, what's your one policy? And Hipkins kind of went free dental for under 30s. That's going to change, you know, that's going to change their life for the next 10 years. And I was kind of like, really? You know,
at least Chris Hipkins had an answer, because Christopher Luxon didn't have an answer to that question.
His was education. And yeah. I think that is the foundation, and actually it was a lot stronger. But on the cost of living, you know, you're absolutely right. Everybody's feeling it. And I suppose that is where it comes down to economic management, that we can see a way out. And I would guess that that's where Luxon was trying to take us last night, that there is, you know, good economic management coming.
I know Paul has come to boost Chris Luxon, but I'm actually going to say, look, I think, again, it was a really good demonstration of why the minor parties are doing well, because I think the minor parties on both sides, on the right and on the left, are doing a much better job of speaking to that issue than the centre parties are.
Because they don't have to worry about then actually being in the big job and having to deliver it. So they can kind of go out there and say anything they
like.
But
here's the thing, though, right?
Not actually
here's the thing. Either Chris is going to have to lead a government where one of those parties is actually going to have a lot of influence. So we might say, oh gosh, there's not really a lot between Christopher Hipkins and Christopher Luxon, but they are going to lead a government that either has Greens and possibly Te Pāti Māori, or ACT and possibly New Zealand First. There's going to be some big, beefy policy expectations there. We're either going to the left or we're going to the right from where we are at the moment. And that's the big decision that the country has to make. Now, who can lead that, you know, pull those parties together and lead them. I would trust someone like Chris Hipkins, who's got the experience and the job and the parliamentary experience, to be able to hold that together.
There was also a lot of agreeing. I think out of those, we saw it in that clip. I think out of the 20 quickfire questions, 19 of them they agreed on.
Wow. Yeah, that's a lot, isn't it?
Yeah.
What a yawn fest.
Yeah.
What a yawn fest.
And this is where people landed. Economist Shamabil Yakub described it to us earlier as grey and beige. Tohenade last night told Jack Tame the clash was boring and mild. Claire Trevett from the Herald called it a snooze fest. Do you think that voters are actually going to be satisfied by last night's debate?
You're watching a debate for entertainment value.
But they are. That's what they want. That's what they want, Paula. We hear the policy on shows like Breakfast all the time. People wanted the fire. They wanted the fight. And I don't know that they got that last night.
I think that they saw a different side to possibly both of them as far as their expectations. But no, I'm not going to sit here and tell you it was riveting TV.
Well,
I was reading Ian's text, so tweets. So there you go.
I think my husband Ryan summed it up best when he turned to me afterwards and said, "We should have watched Celebrity Treasure Island instead." Hey, thank you so much both of you for being with us. That's former Deputy Prime Minister Paula Bennett and former Labor Cabinet Minister Iain Lees-Galloway. Thank you so much for being with us.
Excellent.